This is the fat kid on quarantine, and as you may have noticed, I am wearing a new hat, my new quarantine and chill baseball cap, looking pretty fresh, you know what I'm saying?
Disappointed!
But anyway, that's not important. What is important is that last time on the show, we reviewed the movie Ivan Vassilievich Back to the Future, and we're gonna be reviewing the second part of it today, so let's get started! But first, let's do a recap real quick. Alright, so a scientist invents a time machine, and accidentally sends the Tsar Ivan the Terrible into the modern era while sending two normal guys into the old time. The characters that we met so far were Shurik the scientist, Shurik's wife Zina, Zina's lover Yakin, some kind of Kardashian, the house manager Ivan Vassilievich Bunsha, his wife Karen, the house robber George Miloslavsky, the dentist Anton Semyonovich Shpak, the Tsar Ivan the Terrible, or Ivan Vassilievich Grozny, and the Tsar's assistant, Fedya, who is a walking meme. Speaking of the Tsar, the last time we saw him, our Grand Duke of Russia ran straight into 1973. Let's check in on him. Yes, just as expected of our noble leader, he is being very progressive and discovering such modern marvels as the elevator and toy cars. Sorry, Your Majesty, but you ain't no Dominic Toretto just yet. I have made many mistakes. Alright, well, the Tsar seems to be doing fine so far. I'm not sure how he'll keep managing, but I think he's good for now. Let's check in on George Miloslavsky and Ivan Vassilievich, who got stuck in the past. Huh. You know, I thought they'd be in danger with the Royal Guard chasing them and all, but it seemed like those guys graduated from the Stormtrooper Academy of shooting at things.
Видали, как покойники стреляют?
Yes, George, I do see how the dead are shooting. They're shooting like stormtroopers.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
Ох, тяжко мне.
Well then, it appears that while I was out of it, the movie once again switched times. So, now we're stuck in the modern day.
Спасибо, Иван Васильевич. Произошло замыкание. Перегорели все транзисторы, и пока я не куплю новый, я не смогу вас отправить обратно.
Well, it appears that the Tsar has calmed down and is now enjoying a nice hearty meal with Shurik. And I have to say, I absolutely love the exotic silverware that the Tsar uses while eating. It really conveys a sense of primal power. So I will be now trying it out. I think it's absolutely magnificent, and I believe that this is the only way a real man should eat. Now, before I fully commit myself to this wondrous new method of consumption, I must clarify one thing. Okay. Everyone got that? Okay, good. There we go. And now, let us begin. But how did the Tsar calm down is the question everyone's asking. Well, the answer is the very same way any Russian man calms down, with vodka. I really appreciate that the Tsar was even merciful enough to lower his standards, because look at this, this is clearly not royalty vodka, this is clearly just commoner vodka.
Нет, я не пью, Иван Васильевич, спасибо.
What? What is this? A Russian character that doesn't drink? That can't be right. It's almost like all those ideas that all Russians drink were nothing but stereotypes. How is this possible?
Ты меня уважаешь?
You know, I'm pretty sure he actually doesn't respect you, he's a communist, but I do, and I would love to have a drink with you. However, I'm a minor, so I will enjoy a nice bottle of Diet Mountain Dew. Do the do, guys. Alright, commercial's done, let's continue. The plan to restore the timelines begins now. However, unfortunately, Shuri does not have any Infinity Stones, nor does he have a telephone booth, nor does he have a DeLorean. So, he has to go outside himself and buy parts for his time machine from a store like a chump. But that's not the problem. I mean, it's a problem for Shurik's dignity as a person, but it's not the main issue. And that issue is the fact that the Tsar will be left all alone in Shurik's apartment. And due to the culture shock resulting from various timelines intersecting, the Tsar may be getting into a bit over his head. He may be getting into a bit of trouble. Leaving him alone is extremely dangerous, as the monarch is quite an unstable person. In fact, he has done a lot of awful things in life, such as kill his own son. However, before we look at the Tsar's misadventures, we first need to see what happened to George and Ivan Vassilievich back in time. So... okay, so I took a look at what they're doing, and basically it's a Tom and Jerry chase with everything that you'd expect from something like it. You have them tricking the guards of falling off the roof. You have them pretending to be other people. Look at Ivan Vassilievich over here pretending to be Jesus. Look at him. He ain't no Jesus. Mm-mm. But the guards are stupid enough to fall for it, so it works. And a lot of other wacky stuff happens, but in the end, they find the Tsar's clothes. And Miloslavsky has the genius idea of telling Ivan Vassilievich to dress up as the Tsar in order to fool the guys there into thinking that the Tsar's back and everything's fine. Now, in order to do this, they need to pretend that Miloslavsky is also someone important. So they dress him up as the Tsar's best friend, and they try to put up a ruse that they can hold up until, obviously, Shurik gets his machine working again. Because otherwise, they'll be stuck in the past forever, and eventually they're gonna be found out and killed. Oh, and by the way, real quick, check out Miloslavsky over here pretending to be Alphonse from Full Metal Alchemist. Bruh, you ain't no alchemist, that's not how this works. Mm-mm, you aren't slick, you can't slide this by me. Jokes aside, I do have a point of interest over here that I'd like to discuss for a moment. So, this suit of armor that Miloslavsky gets into to hide from the guards is actually historically inaccurate to the time period and place. Because the Russian Empire did not actually make contact with Western Europe until the time of Peter the Great, which was after Ivan the Terrible. And by that point, it was the time of the Renaissance, not the time of medieval knights and all that. So, technically, the suit of armor should not be here, but, you know, since the movie in the very beginning states that it's not historically accurate, we'll give it a pass here. Back in the modern day, the Tsar is all alone in Shurik's apartment. Let's see what kind of misadventures he gets into. Aw man, you probably shouldn't be touching that thing. That's your only way of getting back. If you break it now, you're stuck here forever. Okay, so if you guys don't mind, I'd like to elaborate on this joke a little bit. So this work of art over here depicts Ivan the Terrible and his son Ivan on November the 16th, 1581. It's a very long name for a painting. So this was created by Ilya Repin in 1885, and as you can see, it depicts the result of a family argument between the Tsar and his son. As you can very well tell, the son loses said argument very badly. The Tsar in the movie doesn't show any visible reaction to the painting, which suggests that this Tsar was plucked from time pre-1581, which suggests that the son is still alive as of the events of the movie. However, he's not seen in the movie because either they didn't need an actor for him, or there wasn't a role for him, or there's something like that. And so the Tsar said, "Let there be light!" Yeah, I heard that Soviet toilets were actually very terrifying. I heard some stories about them. They were more awful than porta potties. That's right, when you don't know anything around you, just go back to the only thing you do know about.
Поговори, ходи со мной, подруга, семиструнная вся душа, полна тобой, а ночь какая лунная игра. Да еще раз, да еще много, 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 много раз. Да еще много, много раз.
Oh, wait, hold on. let me change the music real quick. Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and desert you. I'm going to have fun with this. Yeah, 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 yeah. If you guys want more stuff like this, request more songs and I will put compilations on my channel.
Meanwhile,
Miloslavsky has finished playing dress up with Ivan Vassilievich and is feeling pretty disappointed in his efforts.
Понимаешь, это его лицо умнее. Вот лица попрошу не касаться.
Well, when you see a roast like that, you know what I have to play. Fedya and the others rush into the Tsar's chambers in order to see where did the demons go, just to see Ivan Vassilievich and Miloslavsky. And thus begin the memes. Ah, there we go. There's the first meme. Look at this guy. Look at this dude.
Bruh. Look at this dude. Wait till you see the... No. Ah, look at the top of his head! Look at his lips!
And good lord, there's so much Fedya memes here that I can't even count them all. Actually, that's a lie, I can, but first of all, let me give you an overview of what happens in this scene, and then I'm gonna move on to giving you a compilation of the Fedya memes. So anyway, Fedya starts asking where did the Tsar go, what happened, and Miloslavsky has to awkwardly answer all of his questions, which he does very well, but whenever Fedya asks Ivan Vassilievich something, Miloslavsky has to work for him, and it's really hilarious because he tries literally everything possible to get Ivan Vassilievich to talk, but Ivan Vassilievich is so terrified of what's going on, he doesn't do anything. For example, there's this one beautiful moment where Fedya asks Ivan Vassilievich who is Miloslavsky, and Ivan Vassilievich answers with, "Oh, he's a friend of Anton Semyonovich Shpak."
Ой, дурак.
But you may be wondering, how does this questionnaire end? Well, Князь Miloslavsky, in his infinite wisdom, decides to send the entire army off to war. So, he sends them off to rout the Khan of Crimea from the Izum Road. This is not a joke, this actually happened during the times of Ivan the Terrible. I will send a link in the description below to you guys. So, Miloslavsky forces Ivan Vassilievich to sign this great historical document with a ballpoint pen. So, that has to mess up the timeline. But Fedya just accepts it because he's stupid. Like, I love the guy, but he's stupid. And they go off to war! Just like that! There's no questions asked. The army just leaves. God bless you, you beautiful idiots. So at this point, the scene ends and we're transported back into modern day. However, before we can do that and go on to the next part of the movie, I did promise you a compilation of the Fedya meme faces, and so I give it to you. Get the music. We'll be right back. Meanwhile, in the modern times, the Tsar is still listening to music. This time he's not listening to Vysotsky, but he's listening to a song from another very popular movie called The Diamond Arm. If you want me to cover that movie, please comment below and I'll think about it. The Diamond Arm aside, the Tsar's music time is interrupted by Karen. And, you know, something seems different about her. I don't know quite what it is, but there's something that seems a bit different, you know what I'm saying? So anyways, this Karen 2.0 informs the Tsar that she's searching for her husband, Ivan Vassilievich. Well, she thinks she's informing Shurik because that's who she thinks she's talking to, but it's actually the Tsar. And the Tsar is terrified of this because his name's Ivan Vassilievich too, and he thinks he's the one being searched for. So he quickly turns off the music and frantically waits for Shurik to get home. However, Shurik is in the middle of doing some illegal shopping, so he can't get home. And so, the poor Tsar decides to read some scientific journals and quickly ends up falling asleep. But not for long, because soon, the Tsar's sensitive ears pick up someone entering the flat. He quickly wakes up and hides behind the curtain to see who this mystery person is. Look at that! It's Zina! She's back! In case you guys don't remember, Zina is Shurik's estranged wife who cheated on him with her movie producer and then eloped away. Let's see why she's back. Well, it seems she discovered the existence of the Kardashian. Clearly she couldn't take that much plastic and decided to leave. Honestly, I'm gonna try to keep this subplot simple since it's a little convoluted, but I need to explain it. So basically, we learned that Zina discovered Yakin's mistress. The mistress actually doesn't have a name, I just realized this. That's all we know her as. So I'm gonna be calling her Kardashian from now on. So, Zina discovers the Kardashian, she gets obviously very angry, she returns to Shurik, and then she discovers that she accidentally took Yakin's suitcase when she left him, because their suitcases look exactly the same. Yakin also discovers that Zina messed up the suitcases, so he takes his mistress and drives over to Zina's house in order to get the suitcases back. The mistress doesn't really feel like going with him, so instead she starts phoning all her friends about how excited she is and doing all the classic blonde ditz stuff that you'd expect her to do.
Алло, Анюта, ты себе не представляешь. Я сейчас улетаю в Гагры с самим Якиным. Как, Савельич? Я просто не верю своему счастью.
You know, we here at Fat Kid on Quarantine Productions are not afraid of admitting our mistakes. And so, we here would like to retract our earlier statement. Good God, I haven't seen a gold digger that obvious since the last time I watched the Kanye West music video. Now that that statement has been retracted, let me make a new statement. I have never, and I mean never, seen a gold digger like that. Real quick, look at this Terminator quote that Yakin gives out.
Жди меня, и я вернусь.
Jokes aside, this quote is not at all referring to Terminator. What it is referencing is the poem by Konstantin Simonov, Wait For Me And I'll Come Back. I will put a link to the full poem in the description below if you want to check it out. So anyway, Yakin goes over to Shurik's apartment and the first thing he does is try to explain to Zina what he did and why he did it. But Zina's not having any of it.
Я ухожу от вас. К режиссеру Будимиру Косому. В его постановку Борис Годунов.
Ха-ха, косой халтурщик.
А вы бездарность.
Oh my God, Savage! But there is a detail that is important. Now, Zina just right now mentioned that she's leaving Yakin's movie studio to move to another producer's play, Boris Godunov. Now, this is important because Boris Godunov is a play that is based on real historical events concerning Ivan the Terrible. So, to give you a brief history rundown, Ivan the Terrible dies, and since he killed his son, he doesn't have an heir. Now, this obviously causes a power struggle in Russia after his death, and the guy that takes power for a while is Boris Godunov. During the time of Ivan the Terrible, he was one of the Tsar's boyars that attended court, and for a brief time, he was the man in power after Ivan the Terrible's death. So obviously, this talk of Boris Godunov taking power agitates the Tsar, and he reveals himself. Because obviously, he doesn't know that this is a play. He thinks this is for real, that this is actually something that's gonna happen to him. And it is in the future, but they're talking about a play, he thinks they're talking for real, so he gets very mad.
Какого Бориса царя?
So Yakin, being a producer, thinks that this is some kind of rehearsal. He thinks that Zina actually is practicing for a different production. So he believes that the Tsar is the actor in Akentii Smoktunovsky. And I myself am no producer, but I just cannot see how he arrived to this conclusion. I'm gonna pull up a picture here real quick to show that they do not look at all the same. Huh. You know, actually, now that I'm looking at it, maybe there's something there. When the Tsar realizes that Yakin is confusing him for some random actor, he has the very rational decision of doing the same thing to Yakin that he did to his own son. And this is witnessed by Anton Semyonovich Shpak. He proceeds to inform all of us that he has been robbed, and he's very angry about it, that he has called the police, that they will come with a canine unit, and they will investigate the whole apartment house. You know, my impression of Shpak keeps changing. At first I thought he was comic relief, then I thought he was a minor antagonist, now I just think that he's a male version of Karen.
Oh my god!
However, back to important stuff. The Tsar, who keeps getting angrier and angrier, finally goes full medieval on Yakin and pulls out a knife. And all of a sudden, I have a strong urge to get some armor plating for my groin. But of course, like everything else, Zina ruins it. And in fact, she ruins pretty much everything she's in this movie. She ruins Shurik's relationship. She ruins her own relationship, now she ruins my fun. Dang it, Zina, you're the worst character! By ruining my fun, I of course mean that Zina convinces the Tsar to spare Yakin's life, for some reason. And for some reason, the Tsar does in fact let Yakin go. However, he basically threatens him to take Zina back, or he will kill him. That's right, down on your knees, you beta male! So Zina and Yakin get back together and leave on a honeymoon that seems to be just as sturdy as the average Vegas marriage.
Meanwhile,
back in the past, our two fakers find themselves in the difficult position of having to play host to the Swedish ambassador. So our two boys suit up and get ready to face the music. When the ambassador finally comes in, Ivan Vassilievich manages to do something right and puts on his serious face. Oh, just look at that. Does that look like the face of mercy to you? To me, it looks like the face of a beautiful friendship.
God, it's beautiful!
In fact, Ivan Vassilievich's serious face is weird enough that Fedya feels threatened enough to give us yet another one of his meme faces. The negotiations begin, and while at first both Miloslavsky and Ivan Vassilievich are a bit concerned about the language barrier, that problem is solved by Fedya, who is clearly a man of many talents. Fedya tells us that the Swedish ambassador wishes for the acquisition of these Kamsk region, which is apparently a piece of land that both Sweden and Russia have been fighting over and now wish to solve the problem in a more diplomatic way.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Kamsk Volost. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Now, while Ivan Vassilievich may be fine with giving away prized lands to the foreigners, Miloslavsky really isn't about that nonsense, so he decides to at least take something back in return. Now remember, Miloslavsky is a burglar, he's a thief. Like the average guy from the current Russian government. You know, the kleptomania is strong in this one. Somiloslavsky sidles up to the foreign ambassador and low-key just swipes his very expensive brooch from his chest just like that. I mean, I guess in return for the brooch, he gives the ambassador the ballpoint pen. You know, the very same pen he steals from Spock in the beginning of the movie and then makes Ivan Vassilievich sign historical documents with. This very same pen he gives off to foreign countries. So I imagine how history will look back on this. Like, how did Sweden from the 16th century get this stuff? After the negotiations finish, both Ivan Vassilievich and Miloslavsky realize that they haven't eaten anything since they time traveled, and you know time travel makes your boy hungry, so they decide to have a light snack. Well, let's see what's on the menu today. Now, as you can see, for the appetizer, we have some pork and some Vietnamese faces, along with a side of red caviar. Then, for the main course, we'll enjoy some delectable Vietnamese faces, along with some sturgeon and a side of black caviar. And then, for dessert, we have even more Vietnamese faces. They're really good. And...
Баклажанные.
Hold on. What?
Баклажанные.
Follow me. If it can make caviar, then it's a fish! Now swim, damn you, swim! The instructions were unclear. The eggplant died. It was not a fish. It sunk. Meanwhile, the Tsar is also enjoying a snack. Let's see what's on the menu for the actual Tsar. It's a canned fish sandwich.
Nice.
Le pota.
Yeah, it really is beautiful, but not why you think it is. You see how little traffic there is on the streets? That's not what Moscow looks like right now. You will never ever find this little traffic in the whole city in the 21st century. You know what? Let me put up a picture of how Moscow looks like right now and how it looked like in the movie. Like with all things beautiful, there is also, of course, the Beast. And in the Tsar's case, he's stuck between two of them. On the right of him, we have the Karen, who still thinks this guy is her husband and is nagging at him for being a drunk bastard. And on the left side of him, we have the male version of Karen, aka Anton Semyonovich Spock, who is nagging at him about being robbed. And low-key, that's the only thing he will do for the rest of this movie. That's it, nothing else. The Tsar really doesn't want to deal with these two wildebeests anymore, so he tries to retreat to Shurik's apartment, but Karen doesn't let him and she follows him, which is really weird because she follows him through the window, which should be physically impossible because, as you can see in the previous shot, there is in fact a wall between the two flats separating them, so the only way she could have gotten in is if she wall climbed her way like an Olympic gymnast through the two floors, right? And I don't really want to offend anyone here, but look at this woman's constitution, if you know what I'm saying, and if you look at said constitution, you will see that she looks like an elephant seal that has been fed a steady diet of fast food and cupcakes, which means that there is absolutely no way that she could have gotten through said obstacle, and that makes me very upset, which is why I have been rambling about this topic for nearly 45 seconds now. Now, when the Tsar sees that Karen has entered his inner sanctum, he decides that it's an excellent time to pull out the good old wax staff and beat the crap out of her. However, Karen proves to be quite an agile person and manages to escape and runs off to call the police. The Tsar attempts to chase her down, however, he's stopped by Karen's accomplice, Anton Semyonovich Spock. So, he stops him and once again starts nagging him about, oh man, my house got robbed, everything I own is gone, please take a look at what was stolen from me. And the Tsar is so mad by this point that he just takes the list that Anton Shpak is giving him and just rips it in half and throws it in his face. Take a look at this. Now at this point, Shurik comes back from his illegal shopping spree and attempts to explain to everyone that this is not in fact Ivan Vassilievich, but the real Tsar. But this backfires because the moment Shurik mentions this to Shpak, the guy decides to call up the police and tattletale to them like the complete Karen that he is.
Bruh, look at this dude.
Meanwhile, back in the past, the only characters that I actually care about are still drinking their fill and also eating their fill. But it's Russia, so mostly drinking.
Давай с тобой на брудершафт выпьем. Слушай, старик, у вас в ювелирном магазине драгоценности принимают?
At this point, the Tsaritsa comes in and we are informed that she wishes to see her beloved husband. And the beloved husband, who has been drinking for quite a while by this point and is quite hammered, has gotten his self-confidence up from the alcohol in his system and decides to put the moves on his wife, you know what I'm saying?
Скажите, пожалуйста, у вас нет отдельного кабинета?
О, да ты, ваше благородие, нарезался.
Alright, boys, are you ready for this? Let's take a look at Ivan Vasilievich's flirting skills.
Дорогая царица, очень рад. очень рад познакомиться. Очень рад.
Журнал здоровья так прямо и указывает. Нервные клетки не восстанавливаются.
Okay, that's not bad. Not the smoothest I've ever seen, but okay, that's something. I mean, his skills are good enough for royalty because the Tsaritsa falls for it and, you know, clearly flirts back. So, good for you, Ivan Vasilievich. That's some mad respect right there. However, Miloslavsky isn't about to be left in the dust. So he, like the complete playa and mad lad and absolute god that he is, bags himself the entire group of handmaidens with no shame and absolute chat energy. And the whole group gets hopelessly drunk, which gives us a lot of great Fedya meme faces. And it seems like everything is going great for them before it all hopelessly gets shot to pieces. The generals of the army realize that something isn't right with the Tsar and order the army to turn back.
Войско взбунтовалось. Говорят, царь не настоящий.
And Miloslavsky and Ivan Vasilievich are informed of this, which causes Ivan Vasilievich to sober up at speeds that I don't think are actually physically possible.
Как пропали? Почему?
Both of our boys realize that if Shurik doesn't turn his time machine on in the next 5 minutes, they are dead. Speaking of Shurik, he is about to put the finishing touches on his machine. However, at this point, the interruption comes in the form of cops and they arrest the Tsar. So they interrogate him for a while, but in the end decide that this is basically just Bunsha Ivan Vasilievich that has just been drinking too much and is now delirious and is raving. Oh hey, look at that! Shpak actually got his canine unit.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
Shurik opens his machine just in time to save Miloslavsky and Ivan Vasilievich, who have been busy fighting off the entire Russian army with their food. They managed to pass through the gate just in time, because 1 second further and that would have been it for them. And what's obviously much more important is that we get our last 4 Fedya memes of the entire movie. I'm kinda sad that they're ending, but hey, it was a good run! However, their troubles aren't over yet, because the moment they get back, Ivan Vasilievich tries to go to the police, however, he doesn't get far because he himself gets arrested. So he gets brought in for questioning because he looks exactly like the Tsar, And the moment that that happens, everyone becomes really confused because at first they thought that the Tsar was actually Ivan Vassilievich, who just got drunk and is now raving. But now that a real Ivan Vassilievich has shown up, stuff becomes convoluted. So they bring in Karen, Ivan Vassilievich's wife, for questioning. So she has managed to switch her hair by this point, so she's ready, you know what I'm saying? But when she sees two Ivan Vassilieviches, she goes completely off her rocker and reveals a terrible secret to us. Let's take a look at it. My God, it's horrific! Meanwhile, Miloslavsky steals Shurik's lab coat in order to masquerade himself as one of the doctors that came to take Ivan Vassilievich to the psychiatric ward. So, he almost gets away with it, but then people recognize him and start chasing him around. In the ensuing panic, the Tsar manages to escape and run back to Shurik's apartment and get sent back into his own time. Right as that happens, the movie switches back into black and white and Shurik wakes up. It's revealed that all of this was a dream, Zina never cheated on him, the time machine never activated, all of this was just a fever dream that he had. Or was it now? Thank you so much for watching this review of Ivan Vassilievich Changes Occupation Part 2. If you did enjoy this video, click that like button, click that subscribe button, click that notification button, click all the buttons! And make sure to wait until I come out with my next review, The Neverending Story. This is the Fat Kid on Quarantine, yeeting out. Back.